used mainly for the DM and DNB cardiology residents and also the medicine residents across the country. Last week, we had a session on ECG and congenital heart disease. And this week, we'll continue the series with a very important topic for all the exam-going DM, DNB and MD residents. And to take to this, we have none other than Dr. Prabhavati Madam. Madam is a professor of cardiology in the Jayadeva Institute of Cardiovascular Sciences and Research, Bangalore. Madam needs no introduction. She is a great teacher and has been teaching since last many years. Many of the students in Karnataka and out of Karnataka have been benefited with her classes, including me. So without wasting much time, I will just hand over the session to Madam. Over to you, Ma'am.
Good evening, everybody. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Sudhakar for giving me this opportunity. And I also appreciate his interest and enthusiasm to continue these teaching sessions. Clinical approach to valvular heart disease. All I need to know before the exam, in the exam, even after the exam for routine clinical practice. Here, what I have done is, I am individually dealing with each regions and most common questions asked during the exams. Some questions may look very simple, but I have seen students struggling to answer these. To know about the valvular regions, you need to know the natural history and the hemodynamics properly. So we will start the talk now. The history taking and clinical examination is still an important clinical skill and an art. Despite number of technologies coming in, these skills still remain crucial for accurate diagnosis. Other day, one of our students was asking, is it really important to take history and do examination in a valvular heart disease? Definitely yes. It has been shown that thorough history and proper physical examination can establish diagnosis in nearly 80 to 90% of the patients. Of course, we need echo for confirmation diagnosis and other imagings sometimes to decide about the mode of management. But history plays a very important role in deciding whether patient needs intervention at the presentation or we have to follow. Apart from these, clinical examination also builds a foundation for successful doctor-patient relationship. Valvular heart disease is commonly encountered in day-to-day clinical practice as well as a long case in DM and an important case in DNB also. Rheumatic heart disease is the most common cause of valvular heart disease in India, and we see more often even in the exam rheumatic heart disease. Though there are a number of other causes which you should know, like congenital heart disease, bicuspid aortic valve, represented ASAR, mitral valve collapse, inherited diseases like Marfan's, which may present with AR or MR, degenerative disease, very common cause of aortic stenosis in elderly, and sometimes mitral regurgitation. Endocarditis, especially right-sided, can cause severe tricuspid valve regurgitation. You should also remember some inflammatory immunologic diseases, important one being aortoarthritis, which can cause MR and AR in some patients, especially young females. Myocardial dysfunction can cause MR and tricuspid regurgitation. The rare causes like carcinoid, drugs and radiation also to be kept in mind. So we will start with mitral stenosis. The most common cause up to 98 to 99% is rheumatic. Rare causes which you see sometimes are congenital, even kept for exam sometimes, and degenerative. Extremely rare causes, we will not go into the details of that. What is 4C in mitral stenosis? The most common problem in mitral stenosis is commissural fusion. So that is 1C, it is seen in about 30%. Sometimes cuspal thickening can alone cause mitral stenosis, and sometimes caudal fusion may lead to significant obstruction. Most often it is combined nearly half of the patients. The history of rheumatic fever is obtainable in only 50% and majority of females. What are the symptoms of mitral stenosis? The first thing to happen in mitral stenosis is increase in the left atrial pressure. This leads to pulmonary venous hypertension and congestion in the lungs. So the most important symptom is a progressive exertional dyspnea, which progresses gradually over a period of months to years. As the severity increases, patient may have orthopnea and PAD, or sometimes may present with acute pulmonary edema, especially when there are precipitating factors. They may also have nocturnal cough and wheezing. Hemoptysis is an important symptom in this valvular lesion. It's not seen in other valvular lesions. And winter bronchitis can occur in small percentage of patients. The first bouts of dyspnea are usually precipitated by tachycardia. They'll be asymptomatic, and sometimes even during exercise or with the onset of fever or some infection, and very commonly atrial fibrillation with fast ventricular rate precipitates acute symptoms, because tachycardia shortens the diastole and the gradients increase four times when the heart rate increases twice. Other precipitating factors like pregnancy. Patient may be asymptomatic during the late second trimester or early third trimester. Patient may become symptomatic due to increased heart rate and increase in cardiac output. Other hyperdynamic states like anemia and hyperthyroidism also may precipitate symptoms in patients with moderate to severe mitral stenosis. What are all the mechanisms of dyspnea and mitral stenosis, for that matter, even a left heart failure? The important thing here is elevation of mean left atrial pressure. Any patient with moderate to severe mitral stenosis will have elevated left atrial pressure, which will lead to pulmonary venous hypertension, pulmonary congestion, and interstitial edema. This is the background of symptoms. So the respiratory symptoms are most common in patients with mitral stenosis. So this leads to decreased lung compliance and increased work of breathing. Interstitial edema stimulates the respiration by activating J receptors, juxta receptors, which are present in the alveolar wall. So here is an important piece of information. This was J receptors are described by an Indian scientist, A.S. Painthal. So usually asked in the exam. So the other mechanisms of dyspnea and mitral stenosis is increased airway resistance. They can have wheezing and cough because of edema of the bronchial walls. Decreased cardiac output may lead to fatigue of respiratory muscles that may also contribute to dyspnea. And in chronic congestive heart failure, there may be respiratory muscle myopathy called muscle hypothesis for the explanation of dyspnea. Finally, there can be ventilation perfusion mismatch. All these can contribute to dyspnea and mitral stenosis and all left-sided diseases. What is the difference between dyspnea in MS versus aortic valve disease? Another commonly asked question. Because in mitral stenosis, the first thing to happen is increase in LA pressure. So dyspnea is an early symptom. It is less ominous because they improve with improvement in heart rate or conversion of atrial fibrillation to sinusoidal or control of infection. They improve with a long survival. Whereas in aortic valve disease, the mechanism of dyspnea is because of airway dysfunction, which is a late manifestation. It is more ominous because once they develop dyspnea, it's a downhill course with a survival less than 2 years. So dyspnea in mitral stenosis is less serious than in aortic valve disease. Hemoptysis, this is basically for MD students. It's 5 causes. Although even in DM exam, this is asked, what are the 5 causes of hemoptysis described by Paul Wood? The most important cause is pulmonary apoplexy, which is due to rupture of the thin-walled dilated bronchial veins due to sudden rise in LA pressure. This leads to sudden and severe hemoptysis. Remember that the bronchial veins join the pulmonary veins. Whenever there is increase in LA pressure, pulmonary venous pressure increases and the bronchial veins pressure also increases. This may lead to rupture. Other causes you all know, PND with the blood-stained sputum. During acute pulmonary edema, there may be pink frothy sputum with rupture of alveolar capillaries here. pulmonary infarction, which is a late complication, not seen much in these days, and winter bronchitis also can contribute to pneumonitis. What is the mechanism of winter bronchitis? Though it occurs in small percentage, like nearly 28% of patients in Wood series, this results from chronic passive congestion of the lungs, which leads to chronic bronchial hyperemia and stimulation of goblet cells, leading to hypersecretion of the mucus. And this actually can lead us for infection. Other symptoms are like chest pain, palpitation, maybe paroxysmal due to atrial fibrillation. Systemic embolism is a very important symptom in patients with mitral stenosis, which occurs in 20% of the patients. It's in that two-third maybe cerebral. Hoarseness of voice is a late manifestation called cardiovocal syndrome or Otner syndrome due to compression of the left recurrent laryngeal nerve by the dilated left atrium, or hypertensive left pulmonary artery, or enlarged hilar lymph nodes. In some, the late manifestations of mitral stenosis is right heart failure, secondary to pulmonary hypertension. But a small percentage of MS patients may go on to right heart failure without pulmonary symptoms. Typical anginal pain may be seen in 15% of the patient, and this is due to right ventricular ischemia secondary to pulmonary hypertension and right ventricular hypertrophy. Concomitant atherosclerotic coronary artery disease may be seen in aged patients, which is rare, less common compared to the aortic stenosis patients. Sometimes they may have acute chest pain due to coronary embolism. Other rare symptoms, syncope. Exertional syncope is not a common symptom, but can occur when patient has severe pulmonary hypertension or involved valve thrombus in the LA, including the mitral valve intermittently. We recently had a patient who underwent emergency surgery. Fatigue is again a late symptom. Occurs when patient has severe pulmonary hypertension, and more so when patient goes into right heart failure with tricuspid regurgitation and the cardiac output decreases. So in the history, what favors mitral stenosis? Long history of dyspnea for years with on and off worsening and improving. History of orthopnea and PND, hemoptysis and systemic embolism. These are the symptoms which favor the diagnosis of MS, the history. There are several complications in mitral stenosis. So another common question is, what are the complications unrelated to severity and related to severity? The complications which are unrelated to severity are atrial fibrillation. Atrial fibrillation is more related to age than severity, and of course left atrial size. Again, systemic embolism is related to age and atrial fibrillation. Infective endocarditis is very rare, less than 1% of the cases presenting with infective endocarditis, and about 0.17 per 1,000 patient years. Another favorite question of examiners. Pulmonary hypertension is related to the severity. More severe the MS, more severe is pulmonary hypertension, and it may become suprasystemic. Here, you may be asked another question, what are the other causes for suprasystemic pulmonary hypertension? It may be heritable or idiopathic pulmonary artery hypertension, chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension, and Eisenmenger ASD. You don't get suprasystemic PH in VST Eisenmenger or PD Eisenmenger. You need to remember that. Atrial fibrillation occurs nearly 40% of the patient with mitral stenosis. The strongest predictor is the older age. Below 20 years, we hardly see atrial fibrillation. In spite of severe MS, large LA, we don't see. But above the age of 50 years, majority of them will have atrial fibrillation. Another important predictor is LA size. Atrial fibrillation is rare when the size is less than 40 mm, and increasing size of LA precipitates atrial fibrillation. Initially, it will be paroxysmal. Patient may have paroxysmal palpitation. Later, it is persistent. Here, one need to be careful because they may have regular palpitation because of controlled ventricular rate. They may not be able to tell that it is irregular, and it may increase on exertion because of sympathetic activity increasing AV conduction. So in spite of exertional palpitation, which may patient may say regular, you cannot rule out atrial fibrillation. So In presence of atrial fibrillation, how to measure BP is a difficult task. You may need to take multiple readings, still it may not be accurate. So, PH is the most common complication in mitral stenosis. Invariably, severe mitral stenosis patients will have pulmonary hypertension. And this is one bad lesion where PH is always seen. So, what are the mechanisms? Initially, it is passive pulmonary hypertension due to pulmonary venous hypertension, which is called post-capillary pulmonary hypertension, and it's passively transmitted to the pulmonary arteries. This is reversible after opening the valve. The next is reactive pulmonary hypertension. This is called pre-capillary. This is due to pulmonary vasoconstriction, which is again reversible. It is called second stenosis in the natural history of mitral stenosis. Why does it happen in some and doesn't happen in others? We still don't know. It's still a mystery. Multiple theories are proposed, and most commonly asked is Jordan's hypothesis. Rarely, PH may be contributed by obliterative pulmonary hypertension, which occurs in long-standing mitral stenosis, and it is irreversible. So, passive and reactive are reversible, whereas obliterative is not reversible. What about juvenile mitral stenosis? Another favorite question. It is seen in children or age below 20 years, seen in about 20% of the earlier series. It was first highlighted by Dr. Sujay B. Roy. What are the special features of this? The valve is highly fibrotic with severe submitral disease. So, PTMC results may be suboptimal. Significant pulmonary hypertension is common, but on the other hand, mitral valve calcification, atrial fibrillation, thromboembolism are rare. How to assess severity of mitral stenosis clinically? There are two direct parameters, that is A to OS interval. The shorter A to OS interval, more severe is the mitral stenosis. Usually less than 60 milliseconds suggests severe mitral stenosis. And the length of the marker. As you can see here, mild mitral stenosis, you have a short mid-diastolic murmur after the opening snap, and there is a big gap, and there is a pre-systolic murmur. As the severity increases, this gap is filled, and the murmur starts with the opening snap. The opening snap also comes earlier now, and there is a long diastolic murmur going all the way up to S1 with a pre-systolic accentuation. These are the two important parameters to suggest severe mitral stenosis. Pulmonary hypertension is an indirect evidence of assessment of severity. However, loud S1 and opening snap do not tell us the severity, they only predict leaflet pliability. S1 is an important finding in mitral stenosis. S1 is often loud and palpable, giving a feeling of tapping apical impulse. What is tapping apical impulse? It is a normal apical impulse with a palpable S1. So this usually happens when there is a pliable mitral valve. When do you say loud S1? It's louder than A2 in aortic area. What are the mechanisms of loud S1? Whenever there is severe mitral stenosis or mitral valve closure is delayed, even in moderate MS, mitral valve closure is delayed into the early systole due to increase in the LA pressure. So, because the mitral valve closure is delayed into early systole, mitral valve closes at a high LV pressure. Here, the systole has started and there is a high DPDT. So, valve closure occurs at a higher pressure. Second, because the valve is open at the onset of systole, there is increased distance it has to travel. So these two factors contribute to the loudness of S1. And leaflets and chordae are thickened, not heavily thickened or calcified, but mildly thickened, and they are less compliant. So the entire mitral valve apparatus may resonate giving a loud S1. So here you may be asked, what are the determinants of S1 intensity? So this depends on the structural integrity of the mitral valve, That is what we are discussing. If the mitral leaflets are mildly thickened, you get a loud S1. If it is calcified, maybe the fibrosis, you see there is a mitral disease, S1 may become soft. And the position of the mitral valve or tricuspid valve in your TS at the time of pelvic ventricular contraction. So, other important factor is integrity of isohelmic systole, which is important in patients with mitral regurgitation. We will discuss later. Heart rate and PR interval. Whenever there is tachycardia, you get a loud S1. Whenever PR interval is short, you get a loud S1, because the atrial contraction occurs later and the leaflets are still kept open at the onset of systole. On the other hand, myocardial contractility, if it is reduced, you get a soft S1. If we are hypercontractile in hyperdynamic circulation, you get a loud S1. And another factor is LV end diastolic pressure. These two factors contribute to soft S1 in aortic valve disease. Moving on to S1 in atrial fibrillation. Here, very important to say that S1 is variable, because you start S1 is loud, but before that you have to say variable intensity. It becomes louder after a short cycle because of the high left atrial pressure, and relatively softer after long cycles. Even then, it may be loud in severe mitral stenosis. What are the other causes for variable S1? This is a commonly asked question. Whenever there is AV dissociation, like in complete heart block or ventricular tachycardia, you may get a variable S1. What is opening snap due to? It is due to the sudden halting of the opening motion. And the A to O S interval depends on the LA pressure. And as the LA pressure increases, opening snap occurs early. This is the period of isohelmic relaxation in time. So high LA pressure, opening snap occurs early. It's also affected by other factors. Like, there are two factors which can decrease the A to O S interval and give a false impression of a severe mitral stenosis, that is mitral regurgitation and tachycardia, because both increase the LA pressure, opening snap occurs earlier. Most of the other factors increase A to O S interval, like hypertension, aortic stenosis, LV dysfunction, old age, all these increase the LV end diastolic pressure, so opening snap occurs later. Calcified valve moves slowly, so opening snap occurs earlier. What are the other causes for opening snap? This is another question. It can occur either on the left side or right side. Whenever the flow is increased, like in severe MR, PDA with large left to right shunt, or VSV with large left to right shunt, you can get an opening snap, but it is recorded and most often not audible. So both S1 intensity and opening snap, they go together. Whenever the leaflet is pliable, you get a loud S1 in opening snap. If the leaflets are calcified, non-pliable, especially AML, you get a soft S1. Low cardiac output, severe pulmonary artery hypertension also cause soft S1. LV dysfunction, aortic valve disease also contribute. Remember that S3 and S4 are absent in mitral stenosis because both need an unobstructed AV valve. Wells index, this is purely for the exam. This was used to assess the severity of MS when the echo was not there, but some examiners still ask this question. This needs a phonocardiogram as well as ECG. You calculate QS1 and then A2OS. QS1 minus A2OS is the Wells index. This is supposed to be constant whenever there is varying cycle lengths in atrial fibrillation. The problem in atrial fibrillation is QS1 and A2OS both vary depending on the previous cycle length. A2OS becomes shorter after short cycle, whereas QS1 becomes prolonged after short cycle. So if you use this index, you can predict more accurately the severity. This is only for exam and it is not used nowadays. Murmur occurs in mitral stenosis whenever the gradient is more than 3 mm mercury. It's largely localized to the apex, and the earliest murmur in mild MS is maybe pre-systolic. Is there a correlation between intensity and the severity? Not really. It's related to the velocity of blood flow. Whenever there is high flow, you get a loud murmur. Even in mild MS, in severe MR, because of the large flow, you may get a loud murmur even with a thrill. Or if it's narrow, velocity increases, then also you may get a loud murmur. So you may feel a thrill in thin individuals. So sometimes mitral stenosis murmur may be soft or inaudible. When does it occur? Very severe MS with markedly reduced flow across the mitral valve, called low flow. Recently this is also described, low flow, low gradient mitral stenosis. Whenever there is severe pulmonary hypertension, heart failure, markedly reduced flow can reduce the gradient. Marked RV enlargement shift the apical limbus posteriorly, so you will not be able to hear the murmur. Of course, extensive calcification and subvalvular disease also may not have a good murmur. Associated other diseases like aortic valve disease can reduce the intensity of murmur. Of course, in ASD, you hardly get a murmur. We'll move on to the mitral regurgitation. Mitral regurgitation can be primary due to abnormal mitral valve apparatus. Two common causes of chronic rheumatic heart disease and myxomatous mitral valve disease. Secondary is functional MR due to LV dilatation and dysfunction seen in ischemic heart disease and dilated cardiomyopathy. Chronic severe MR, usually the symptoms develop late with a long asymptomatic period. The earliest symptom may be palpitation due to volume overload, and it is usually exertion. Exertional fatigue due to decrease in effective forward stroke volume is an important symptom. Dyspnea occurs in the late period of MR. Sometimes mild to moderate MR may present with infective endocarditis. Usually the dyspnea occurs late due to LV dysfunction, and it is slowly progressive. Sometimes even a significant LV dysfunction, they may not have dyspnea. Whenever there is rapid progression of dyspnea in MR, think of recurrence of rheumatic activity in children or caudal rupture causing acute severe MR. It may be spontaneous or in patients with infective endocarditis, and sometimes an acute rheumatic fever. Infective endocarditis can cause acute worsening. Another important thing is onset of atrial fibrillation. Increase in the heart rate, there are more V waves causing elevation in the main left atrial pressure. Sometimes patients with moderate MR develop severe hypertension, may go into acute left ventricular failure. Chest pain is not a common symptom in MR, but in mitral valve prolapse, usually atypical chest pain, sometimes typical of myocardial ischemia, may be there. This is due to abnormal tension on the back of the muscles. What are the clinical features of chronic severe MR? Cardiomegaly with dilated hyperdynamic left ventricle is common in severe MR, not in mild to moderate MR. And late systolic left parasternal pulsations, widespread second sound due to delayed A2, LVS3 sometimes palpable with a mid-diastolic rumble, such as severe mitral regurgitation. Is there a correlation with the intensity of murmur or presence of thrill? Not really. Pulmonary hypertension can occur in patients with acute MR or in the late stages of chronic MR. Very commonly asked question about the pulse in mitral regurgitation. In severe MR, the carotid upstroke is sharp. They call it a small water hammer pulse. The carotid upstroke is quick and sharp. Then nothing else. There is no collapsing pulse. There is no change in the blood pressure, or the pulse volume is normal or even decreasing in severe MR. So it's only the rapid upstroke which they call a small water hammer pulse. Apical impulse is hyperdynamic. It becomes sustained when there is LV dysfunction. So if there is a late systolic left parasternal pulsations, this can be due to a large regurgitant jet into the dilated left atrium. This is not because we are palpating, we are able to palpate the LA pulsations. It is the outward movement of the anterior cardiac structures due to large regurgitant jet in the LA, and it mirrors the large LA V wave. This is not synchronous with the apical impulse because it is late, it is asynchronous, whereas pulmonary hypertension can cause parasternal heave, which has to be differentiated from this late systolic parasternal pulsations because this indicates severe MR. The parasternal heave is more medial, it coincides with the apical impulse and associated with epigastric pulsations and other findings of pulmonary hypertension. S1 is usually soft because of loss of isohelmic systole. Especially in rheumatic MR, the mitral valve leaflets are non-coaptane. So, the MR starts during the isohelmic period itself, isohelmic systole, because there is no coaptation of the leaflets. Isohelmic systole means both the valves are closed and the pressure builds up in the left ventricle. So, the MR starts and significant MR occurs during the isohelmic phase of the systole, and this can blur the S1. What are the other causes of loss of isohelmic systole? Large ventricular septal defect, severe aortic regurgitation, and LV aneurysm. However, S1 can be loud when it is associated with mild mitral stenosis. In mitral valve prolapse, with a holosystolic mitral valve prolapse with MR, the freely mobile AMF can cause a loud S1, and the non-ejection click can fuse with the S1, and S1 can be loud holosystolic and MR. Second heart sound is important in assessing the severity. It's wide and variable because of the early A2. A2 occurs early because of decrease in the LV ejection time. Now LV has two outlets. It pumps into the LA as well as aorta, and the ejection time is shortened. So you get an early A2. When do we get a narrow split in MR? Whenever there is onset of LV dysfunction, A2 will be delayed, so you get a narrow split. The other mechanism is development of pulmonary hypertension. Here, due to decrease in hangout interval, P2 occurs early and causes a narrow split. Loud P2 is a feature of severe pulmonary hypertension. S3 in MR indicates severe MR because of large flow across the mitral valve. It doesn't indicate LV dysfunction. Important point about S4 is it is absent in tonic severe MR, especially in rheumatic MR, for two reasons. One, LV is compliant. What are the prerequisites for S4? Forceful atrial contraction, unobstructed AV valve, and a stiff non-compliant LV. Here in chronic severe MR, LV is compliant, so the atrial boost is not needed. The other important point is here the LA is damaged because of the previous rheumatic carditis, fibrosis, long-standing atrial distension. LA is like a big bag and it doesn't effectively contract. So there is no S4 in rheumatic MR. Whereas loud S4 is a feature of acute MR and the MR associated with coronary artery disease or hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. Systolic murmur in MR is, especially in rheumatic heart disease, is pansystolic and S1 coinciding. That means it starts with S1 and continues beyond A2 and sometimes obscuring the A2 because there is a persistent gradient across the LV LA even in the later part of system. However, in acute MR, it is early systolic because of rapid equalization of pressure in the LA during the later part of system. Another commonly asked question is when MR murmur is not S1 coinciding. In MAP MR, moderate MAP or mild moderate MAP MR, there will be click either in the mid to late part of the systole, and the murmur is late systolic. Depending on how severe is the prolapse, the murmur occurs either in the mid systole or in the late systole. In ischemic MR, like papillomavular dysfunction or during acute ischemia, it is late systolic. MR in HOCM is again occurs in the later part of systole. Remember that eject, obstruct, leak So there is a rapid ejection initially, then obstruction, because the SAM mitral valve participates in the systolic antral motion, that is leak. So it occurs in the later part and not S1 coinciding. So another important feature of MR murmur is there is no beat-to-beat change in the murmur intensity, unlike the AS murmur, where the intensity changes with changing cycle length. Even after a long cycle, MR murmur remains same. Why does it happen? You should remember the three hemodynamic changes which occurs after a VPC or during a long cycle. One, because of the long cycle, there is extra volume of blood received by the left ventricle. Second, this extra volume leads to increase in contractility of the left ventricle, Starling's mechanism. There is even extra systolic potentiation following an ectopic. Third, because of the long diastole, the aortic pressure continues to fall and this results in decreased afterflow. What happens in MR? Because there is large amount of forward flow into the aorta, the regurgitant flow and the murmur remain the same. So this results from decreased afterflow. Large amount of blood goes to the aorta and the regurgitant flow remains same, no beat-to-beat variation. Classically, the murmur radiates to the axilla and left infrascapular area, classically, rheumatic heart disease, because more often it is AML, which fails to coapt to the PM. Irrespective of etiology, the murmur is maximum at the apex. When is the radiation of the murmur toward the sternum? Most importantly, it is because of prolapse or flail of the posterior mitral leaflet when the jet comes anteriorly and murmur may be heard in the base, sometimes may be mistaken for aortic stenosis. Two congenital heart diseases like AV septal defect with left AV valve regurgitation and corrected transposition with left AV valve regurgitation, murmur usually is directed towards the sternum and heart medium. Murmur can be soft or absent in patients with DCM, dilated cardiomyopathy with LV dilatation, murmur may be soft. And MR related to coronary artery disease during acute MI, papillary rupture causing acute MI, acute MR, or chronic ischemic MR, murmur is either soft or sometimes not audible. Paraprosthetic valvular regurgitation, also the murmur may be not audible. Diastolic flow murmur, which is commonly heard in severe mitral regurgitation, is usually low pitched, mid diastolic, and decrescendo. If there is severe MR, it may be even associated with the thrill. But the presystolic accentuation is not a feature. If there is presystolic accentuation, loud S1 and opening snap, you have to consider associated mitral stenosis. Patient has severe MR, but there is no flow murmur. What are the causes? Most important cause is the LV dysfunction. In ASD with MR, most of the blood goes towards the right atrium through the atrial septal defect. The flow across the mitral valve is reduced, so you don't get a MDM flow murmur. Acute MR also, you may not get a flow murmur. In acute MR, S1 will be soft, invariably there will be loud P2 and S3. S4 is loud, often palpable, and the murmur is only early systolic, the decrescendo, because of rapid equalization of pressure in the left atrium. We move on to the aortic stenosis. We are all aware of the three major causes: rheumatic, where invariably MV is involved, they present during 3rd, 4th decade, congenital, bicuspid aortic valve is the most common, present in the 5th and 6th decade, and degenerative, seen in 12% over 75 years, they present in 7th, 8th decade. There are some rare causes like familial hypercholesterolemia and radiation. half of the patients, even with severe aortic stenosis, may be asymptomatic. The earliest symptom is dyspnea and fatigue on exertion due to airway dysfunction and low cardiac output. Aortic angina may be seen in nearly one-third of the patients. They may have associated coronary artery disease, especially elderly patients with calcific degenerative aortic stenosis. Dizziness or syncope, again exertional, may be seen in 50 to 30% of the patients. Whenever there is anemia, look for GI bleed due to angiodysplasia of the colon. What are the mechanisms of angina and aortic stenosis? Very favorite question of the examiner. The angina typically resembles angina in coronary artery disease. It may be due to increased demand because of the hypertrophied myocardium, and the systole is prolonged, mechanical systole is prolonged because of the obstruction, systole is prolonged, so that demands more blood, more oxygen, and there is increased wall stress because of highly increased pressure in the left ventricle. On the other hand, there is decreased supply also because there is decreased capillary density. There is hypertrophy, but capillaries don't increase in the density. And increased LVEDP causes decrease in the coronary perfusion pressure. Coronary perfusion pressure is coronary diastolic pressure minus left ventricular end diastolic pressure. So when the LV end diastolic pressure increases, coronary perfusion pressure decreases and there is decreased coronary blood flow. Because the systole is prolonged, diastole is shortened, so this also contributes to decreased supply because coronary blood flow occurs mostly during diastole. Associated coronary artery disease should be suspected whenever there is recent onset angina. Dyspnea could be due to diastolic or systolic LV dysfunction. Once they develop dyspnea due to LV systolic dysfunction, their survival is usually less than 2 years. But remember, some patients can have long-standing mild dyspnea due to diastolic dysfunction. Exertional dyspnea and syncope. The mechanism of which is controversial. The standard explanation is inability to increase the cardiac output due to fixed LVOT obstruction and the small LV which is not able to increase the cardiac output. But another explanation is dissolved Jarisch reflex. Marked increase in the LV systolic pressure causes stimulation of the mechanoreceptors and a reflex vasodilatation, hypotension and bradycardia, that is dissolved Jarisch reflex, contributes to exertion and syncope. Most often it is exertional, but sometimes syncope can occur at rest. This may be due to transient atrial fibrillation because of loss of atrial boost, which contributes to about 40% of the LV filling in patients with severe aortic stenosis. Another reason for syncope at rest is transient AV block due to extension of calcification into the AV node. What are the clinical features of severe aortic stenosis? Pulsus parvus et tardus, that is slow rising pulse and low volume pulse. Low systolic blood pressure with a narrow pulse pressure, epicocarotid delay. Heaving apical impulse, which is not displaced, either a paradoxical split S2 or a single S2. Presence of LV S4, long and late peaking systolic murmur, all these suggest a severe aortic stenosis. We'll briefly see about each one of these. Carotid pulse, it is slow rising and late peaking, which is more important than the low volume to signify severity. That is delayed upstroke. What is anacrotic pulse? Another commonly asked question, and you may be even asked to draw what is anacrotic pulse, what is normal pulse, what is dysferial. So the anacrotic pulse is used interchangeably, pulsus parvus et tardus, but more specifically, it is a slow rising pulse with a notch or a shoulder on the ascending limb that can be recorded and not palpated. In non-elastic vessels, especially in elderly, this is difficult because they may have associated hypertension and the vessels are stiff significant AR also can mask. In supravalvar aortic stenosis, the Coyne effect, the blood, the jet tries to adhere to the vessel wall and preferentially flows into the innominate artery. Of course, in low stroke volume also, it is not classically appreciable. What happens to the blood pressure in severe aortic stenosis? Systolic BP becomes lower, especially in children and young adults, and diastolic BP goes up because of left ventricular hypertrophy, diastolic dysfunction, and vasoconstriction. However, in elderly, systolic BP may go higher because of the non-compliant vasculature. An important point to suggest severity in aortic stenosis is apico-carotid delay. When you palpate the carotid artery and apical impulse simultaneously, you can appreciate a distinct lag between the initial systolic thrust at the apex and the peak of the carotid pulse. This is called apico-carotid delay. This is easier to elicit than the pulse's tardus. This is shown to be highly sensitive with a high specificity and positive predictive value. Heart sounds, S1 may be normal, become soft in LV dysfunction. S3 occurs only when there is LV dysfunction in adults. In children, there may be physiological S3. S4 is important to tell the severity. Whenever there is palpable S4 at any age, it is abnormal, indicates a gradient, LV aortic gradient of 70 mm of mercury or more. Whereas audible S4 in elderly or with hypertension or coronary artery disease has less significance because these diseases itself or in older age itself can have a S4. So S4 is absent in atrial fibrillation because there is no effective atrial contraction. S2 again is important in assessing the severity. A2 may be prominent in pliable non-calcified bicuspid aortic valve in children and young adults, whereas it becomes soft in calcified valve over the age of 40 years. In severe aortic stenosis, A2 is delayed, it moves into the P2. So most often you get a single second sound. This may be due to delayed A2, where A2 coincides with the P2, or ear cannot appreciate them as two sounds when the distance between two sounds is less than 30 milliseconds. A2 may be inaudible because of calcification, or because of the long murmur going all the way up to the delayed A2, P2 may be buried in the murmur. Paradoxic split, seen in small percentage of patients, so there is severe ASCL gradient more than 75 mm mercury. Ejection click may be heard in bicuspid aortic valve, which is constant, doesn't move with respiration. It's best heard in the left sternum border and sometimes in the apex. Even without aortic stenosis, you can get this click. And most often heard in children and young adults, unusual beyond 40 years because of the calcification. This goes with the A2. Oh, it is like S1 and opening snap. Here it is click and A2. There is no correlation with severity. The murmur, it's a mixed frequency murmur with a rasping and grunting quality, best heard in the aortic area or left second of the intercostal space or herbs area. In calcified aortic valve, the long systolic musical murmur may be heard in the apex with a higher frequency component heard in the apex, giving an impression of a MR murmur. This is called Gallivadin's phenomenon. How to differentiate it from MR? As we already discussed, post-ectopic or after long cycle, AS murmur increases, whereas MR murmur does not change. When there is LV dysfunction or low output state, the murmur becomes soft and sometimes even absent. So quickly go on to the aortic regurgitation. It can be due to primary disease of the aortic valve or aortic root problem like Marfan's or bicuspid aortic valve. The most common symptom may be palpitation, which may be present at rest or on exertion. Angina could be exertional or nocturnal. Dyspnea is the late manifestation, always due to LV dysfunction. Here also, angina can be due to increased demand due to increased LV mass or decreased flow, coronary blood flow due to coronary decrease for only perfusion. Nocturnal angina may be troublesome in some patients. Mechanisms described are decrease in heart rate causes prolongation in the diastole, which increases aortic regurgitation and results in increase in LV and diastolic pressure. So this again decreases the coronary perfusion pressure and coronary blood flow. Another important mechanism is diastolic coronary stealing. Because of the AR jolt, there is Venturi effect with a flow reversal in the coronaries, causing decreased flow. Dyspnea is a late manifestation. Even with the ejection fraction of some 35-40%, they may be asymptomatic. Dyspnea progresses slowly. If it occurs early in the course, so think of acute AR or associated nitrostenosis, the rapid progression of dyspnea can occur in patients with infective endocarditis or hypertension. Chronic severe AR is diagnosed mostly by the peripheral signs. Of course, the length of the murmur and austenitic murmur is useful to assess the severity. The Hill sign, most controversial one, it's considered as a sphygmomanometric artifact because there is no difference intra-arterially, but it is still used to assess the severity. All the peripheral signs may be absent in patients with LV dysfunction, acute AR, or associated other bilateral lesions. Carotid pulse in aortic regurgitation could be experienced with two peaks. What is the explanation? Initially, it is thought that it is prominent percussion wave causes the first, and the exaggerated tidal wave due to reflected waves from the periphery causes the second wave. How to differentiate from hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy is the first peak is more prominent in HOCM, whereas in AR, both peaks may be equal or the second peak may be more prominent than the first peak. Another mechanism described is Venturi effect. Because of the rapid jolt, which has a suction effect, causes mid-systolic dip in the pressure. Carotid shudder, it is a quiver or vibration seen at the height of the carotid pulse as described by William Evans. And according to him, it was seen only in the combined ASR. But later in 1976, Alpert demonstrated equal incidence of carotid shudder in all the three groups, that is AS, AR and combined ASR. This is by carotid pulse tracing. It's not a inspectory or palpatory finding. It is demonstrated in carotid pulse tracing. Blood pressure, we should measure in both upper limbs and one lower limb. The cuff can be put around the calf. Don't look for a thigh cuff because you never get a bigger cuff. We can use the dorsalis pedis or posterior artery to measure the systolic blood pressure. So systolic blood pressure is usually increased to 140 or 150. Diastolic pressure is low. You have to take muffling. If the difference between muffling and the disappearance is more than 10 mm, you are supposed to mention both. In reality, diastolic pressure will not go below 30. Lower the diastolic pressure, wider the pulse pressure, indicates severe aortic regurgitation. What are the basis of peripheral signs, or what are the prerequisites for peripheral signs in AR? One is the white pulse pressure, and more important is the low diastolic pressure. Why there is low diastolic pressure? This results from reflex vasodilatation. Because of the large stroke volume, there is reflex vasodilatation and falling systemic vascular resistance. The most important peripheral signs are neurosis and Hill sign. One commonly asked question is, what is one sign of central runoff? That is neurosis murmur. And what are the other causes for central runoff? Large PDA, AP window with last left right shunt and ruptured sinus of false valve. In all these conditions, you can get a central runoff and a neurosis murmur. So this is the evidence to show that neurosis murmur and Hill sign have higher sensitivity and specificity. In AR, S1 may be soft and they develop LV dysfunction. S2, A2 is delayed due to longer LV ejection. and also due to increased hangout interval in patients with dilated aorta or due to systemic vascular resistance is lower. Paradoxical split is uncommon, may occur when there is LVBB or LV dysfunction. A2 may be soft in valvar, whereas normal or loud in aortic root abnormalities. Here, in contrast to MR, S3 indicates LV dysfunction, especially in old adults. S4 can be there in LV dysfunction. So, how to differentiate AR due to valve pathology and aortic root pathology? Due to aortic root dilatation, there may be dullness in the right upper sternal border because of the dilated aorta. A2 is usually loud as described in syphilitic air like tambour quality, and air murmur is heard better on the right sternal border than on the left sternal border called Harvey's sign. Whereas in valve pathology, A2 may be soft because of damage to the valve leaflets, and early diastolic murmur is better heard in the left third intercostal space. Acute AR, the findings will be entirely different. They may present with acute heart failure or pulmonary edema. BP will be normal or decreased, no peripheral signs, signs of heart failure like JVP elevation, palpable S3 may be there, and early diastolic murmur may be short and soft. Briefly about tricuspid valve, usually they will have long history of symptoms and there will be improvement in symptoms of left pulmonary venous hypertension like dyspnea, P and the orthopnea comes down, whereas the symptoms of right heart failure increases like fatigue, anorexia, and edema. It's almost always associated with mitral valve disease. Tricuspid regurgitation is most often functional, caused by dilatation of the annulus whenever the RV or PA pressure goes beyond 55 millimeter mercury, the TR starts appearing. In 15 to 30%, it may be organic due to direct involvement of the tricuspid valve. Always associated with mitral valve disease and rheumatic heart disease. What are the other causes for the low pressure TR? It's a common question. Here I would like to draw your attention that atrial fibrillation and these pacing leads can cause significant tricuspid regurgitation. Symptoms are of low cardiac output and right heart failure. Sometimes they may complain of throbbing neck pulsations due to prominent V waves. What are the non-cardiac findings in severe tricuspid regurgitation? Because of chronic venous congestion, there may be pulsatile proptosis. Icterus may be present due to hepatic congestion. Engorged neck veins with earlobe pulsations. Head bobbing, that is no-no movement or right-left, not anterior-posterior, which is commonly seen in AR. Pulsatile liver, ascites, splenomegaly, peripheral edema, and cachexia due to protein-losing enteropathy are commonly seen in long-standing severe TR. JVP is a useful clue. There will be dominant CV wave or called S wave, the NCC sign. Whenever there is a prominent V wave, we get a steep Y descent, and there may be inspiratory swelling of the venous pulse. If you auscultate, you may get distal short sounds. What are the findings in severe tricuspid regurgitation? Prominent V waves, systolic hepatic pulsations, and pansystolic murmur in the lower left sternal border, which increases on inspiration and passive leg raising. There may be RVSV and short LVM because of increased flow. High pressure TR will have features of pulmonary hypertension, prominent P wave, and high-pitched pan-systolic murmur, whereas low-pressure TR will have less prominent JVP in hepatic pulsation. The murmur is early systolic, decrescendo, and more often low-pitched. It may be even soft or inaudible in PMF and RVMI. Tricuspid stenosis, almost always rheumatic, accompanied by mitral valve disease, sometimes aortic valve disease, associated with TR, clinical TS is seen in about 5% of the patients and it's more common in PVs. Again, progressive fatigue due to low cardiac output and symptoms of right heart failure. Whenever there is peripheral edema and ascites out of proportion to pulmonary symptoms, think of tricuspid stenosis. JVP is the key with a prominent A wave, and explore why it is. There may be pre-systolic pulsatile liver, but most often they will have atrial fibrillation, so these findings may not be there. Pulmonary hypertension is less common. There may be murmurs of mitral and aortic valve disease. The classical finding of tricuspid stenosis like loud T1, opening snap, and murmur of tricuspid stenosis is heard in lower left sternal border. All these may be mistaken for mitral stenosis, so it is difficult to pick up in patients with severe mitral stenosis. But the one point is inspiratory augmentation of this murmur. This murmur may be pre-systolic or mid-diastolic in terms of atrial fibrillation. Crossleaf, just summarizing, JVP in valvular heart disease, when it is grossly elevated, think of right heart failure or TV disease. Prominent V, TR. Prominent A, suggests pulmonary hypertension or Bernheim's effect in severe aortic stenosis. Prominent A with slow wide descent, significant tricuspid stenosis. Of course, it is absent in atrial fibrillation. Epical impulse in valvular heart disease, that is in severe valvular heart disease. Mitral stenosis, it is normal or decreased amplitude. When there is severe RV enlargement, RV forms the apex and it may be diffuse. Chronic MR and AR, dilated hyperdynamic LV, when it is sustained, think of LV dysfunction. Aortic stenosis, heaving but not displaced. When it is displaced, consider LV dysfunction or significant regurgitant lesions. Increase in the diameter of the apical impulse is more predictor of LV enlargement. Finally, how do you assess pulmonary venous hypertension clinically? History-wise, moderate pulmonary venous hypertension can be suspected when there is PND or class 2 dyspnea, whereas severe pulmonary venous hypertension is considered when there is orthopnea or pulmonary edema. An escape trial in heart failure, orthopnea was the only symptom, orthopnea requiring 2 pillows or more predicted pulmonary capillary wedge failure of more than 30 mm mercury. These are the commonly asked questions in the exam. How to assess pulmonary venous pressure? Because these days they expect you to say whether there is pulmonary venous hypertension or not. So even looking at the JVP, you can assess the pulmonary venous pressure. JVP in general estimates RV filling pressure, but jugular vein distension in patients with left heart disease signifies increased pulmonary capillary pressure with a high sensitivity, specificity and predictive value. Drasner et al. Found that RV pressure more than 10 mm mercury predicts pulmonary capillary wedge pressure of more than 22 mm mercury with a high predictive value. An escape trial, again RV pressure more than 12 was associated with pulmonary capillary wedge pressure more than 22. Abdominal jugular reflex, which is positive, again pulmonary artery wedge pressure more than 15 mm mercury. Clinical features of pulmonary hypertension should be looked for, especially when there is severe mitral stenosis. Even in late stages of other valvular lesions, you can get pulmonary hypertension. The prominent A wave, parasternal heave and epigastric pulsations, pulmonary artery pulsations, loud palpable PT, which is widely heard, and on auscultation, we may hear TR or PR. Sometimes they may suddenly ask, what are the palpatory findings of pulmonary hypertension? Like parasternal heave, PA pulsations, loud palpable, very palpable pulmonary component of second sign. So severe PH, left parasternal heave, which is grade 3, loud P2, which is widely audible, and the murmur of TR indicates severe pulmonary hypertension. Sometimes PH findings may be masked. Your patient may have class 3 dyspnea, but there is no findings of pulmonary hypertension clinically. So you may say moderate pulmonary venous hypertension, but normal PA pressure. He should not tell you, because whenever there is pulmonary venous hypertension, there has to be pulmonary arterial hypertension. So it may be missed or masked in patients with chest deformities or previous surgery, elderly, and emphysematous chest. In the final diagnosis, you are supposed to tell the etiology, combination and severity of each lesion, pulmonary venous hypertension and pulmonary arterial hypertension, rhythm, heart failure is there or not, what is the MHA class, whether there is any features of rheumatic arthritis and infective endocarditis, if possible, whether there is every dysfunction or not, and of course, precipitating factors. Thank you for patient care. I think I exceeded time by 5 minutes. Sudhakar, sorry for that.
That was too elaborative, ma'am. I initially thought of writing the question which was not covered, and I have not written on one question also, ma'am. I think it is so elaborative, every question related to all the valvular heart disease that discussed everything.
Okay.
I will just do a few questions which are there in the chat box, ma'am.
Okay. I don't know whether I'll be able to answer, but I see.
Yeah, how much we can, ma'am?
Yeah.
Why do we get a loud P2 in acute AR?
Because acute AR causes elevation of LV end-diastolic pressure and LA pressure increases and the patient develops pulmonary hypertension. Acute elevation of the pulmonary pressure. They are always present with BHS.
Right. Then, they also want if we can that effect of VPC on afterload in MR.
Want again explanation?
VPC reduced afterload.
Yeah, prolonged diastole. See, after VPC you have a long pause, right?
Yes.
Before the next beat comes, there's a long pause. During this period, three hemodynamic things happen. One, there is increased filling of the LV. Second, there is increased contractility. Both increase the forward flow. And one more thing is, because of the long diastole, there is fall in the systemic vascular resistance. So this, all these three contribute to more forward flow and the MR murmur remains same, whereas AS murmur increases after a long cycle. Is that clear?
Then there is another question on how to differentiate severe AR with basically flow murmur in AR with an organic AS murmur.
This we discussed in multivalent disease, so I didn't bring it today. One is the murmur, functional AS murmur is usually not that harsh and rasping, whereas organic AS will have a harsh rasping murmur. And more importantly, the murmur of organic AS will be long and late picking, whereas functional AS murmur is usually mid-systolic and early peaking.
And does the concept of systolic decapitation still exist?
Yes, it does exist, because in aortic regurgitation, the murmur, the blood systolic blood pressure is usually high in the range of 140-150 because of ejection of large amount of blood, increased stroke volume. But when there is LV dysfunction or associated other valvular lesions like aortic stenosis or MR, the systolic blood pressure is less.
This doubt I always get, ma'am. See, suppose a patient has isolated aortic stenosis and has a BP of 100. In that case, will you call it decapitation or no?
No, that is not really decapitation. That is a feature of severe aortic stenosis.
Right.
I don't know.
Only in a patient like AS and AR and all, if you
correct,
get a lower
systolic. Yes. Right. Where you expect a high pressure, but you have a low pressure.
Right. How to differentiate a functional TR from an organic TR? I think you have already discussed, ma'am.
Yeah.
Short murmur, low pitched murmur, and a high JVP in a hypertensive TR.
Yes.
Yeah, right, ma'am.
Sometimes in organic, severe organic TR, the murmur may be even absent. Whereas in functional TR, murmur is loud and pansystolic.
So, what?
With prominent hepatic pulsations and prominent P waves, which are not that prominent in organic TR.
Somebody asked, I think, Ponda effect. I think you have already told, ma'am, the selective streaming in supravalvular
aortic stenosis is selective streaming into the innominate artery. So you have a better pulsation on the right common carotid, and the right upper limb pulses are better felt in the BP. Is BP difference of more than 10 millimeter mercury will be appreciated.
There is one more question, which is a very good question. I think what determines a dominant lesion in case of multivalvular? What all determines a dominant lesion?
That means clinical findings or?
Clinical finding, yeah. Yes, ma'am. Yes. Basically, I think it's based on like pulse, means based on apex or what, I think they want to.
No, it depends on the individual lesion. Right. Usually, if it is dominant lesion, will manifest with the findings which we already discussed. Suppose there is a severe aortic stenosis and mild moderate AR, it behaves more like a AS than AR.
Right.
Anyway, any proximal lesions can attenuate the distal lesions. So that we have to keep in mind. For example, severe tricuspid stenosis or tricuspid regurgitation can underestimate mitral and aortic disease.
Okay. Post VPC changes in pulse pressure are due to what? Why are the post VPC changes in pulse pressure?
In AS patients or which patients?
It's written general.
So post VPC, that's what? The stroke volume increases. So the systolic pressure should increase.
And is there a difference between a means currently we use it synonymously? Is there a difference between a conduction and a radiation?
Actually, it is used interchangeably. I still don't know.
So I think before, madam, they used to tell na along the same, if it conducts along the same path.
We use, you know, in MR also we say it radiates. Yes, also, yeah, it's.
So better at the current practice, we don't use it.
Actually, there is confusion among the cardiologists.
Right. Then, one question, I think more theoretical. Explain the preload and afterload mismatch causing LV dysfunction.
In aortic stenosis,
yes.
LV dysfunction can be because of afterload mismatch. See, there are three mechanisms for LV dysfunction in aortic stenosis. One important is afterload mismatch. Whenever there is obstruction to the LVOT, what is the response of the LV? Hypertrophy. This hypertrophy is inadequate to the degree of obstruction. Then there is afterload mismatch and EF comes down. Second, because of the thick, non-compliant LV, the preload also is reduced. So this can also contribute to LV dysfunction in patients with severe aortic stenosis. The third one is contractile dysfunction. That occurs late in the natural history of aortic stenosis. That is why in AS with LV dysfunction, LV function improves after removing the obstruction, because you are removing the afterload and LVH comes down, so preload also improves. So LV function improves. Most often it improves unless there is contractile dysfunction. Is it clear?
Right. One more thing which I think they ask very commonly, non-inspiratory rise of PR murmur. When can we expect?
Which one?
PR, a non-inspiratory rise.
Pulmonary regurgitation. Is it PR or?
TR, ma'am. TR. Tricuspid
regurgitation. Yeah, okay. TR murmur, whenever there is RV failure, RV dysfunction, it cannot accept that extra volume and regurgitate. So, whenever there is RV dysfunction, you may not get the classical inspiratory increase. This can be brought out if you make the patient sit with the legs dangling or standing. This decreases the venous return, and then maybe you will be able to appreciate the respiratory variation. RV dysfunction is one thing. In ASD also, there may not be inspiratory increase.
even associated tricuspid stenosis, ma'am?
Tricuspid stenosis they can have.
One more question, like this Friedreich's sign we use very commonly. Should the word be used specifically only for constrictive pericarditis or any disease which causes rapid
wide descent? It is for prominent wide descent, though I think it was described in constrictive pericarditis. It is any rapid wide descent is Friedreich's sign.
And which opening snap occurs first, mitral stenosis or tricuspid stenosis opening snap? One more question.
I think which one opens first? It depends on the severity. Normally, I have to.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I have to refer. I don't remember.
Anybody is there who wants to talk? And they have one question, how do you differentiate X and a Y descent clinically?
See, X descent occurs during systole. So it is pulse coinciding. So if you palpate the pulse, it comes with the pulse. Whereas Y descent comes during diastole. So it is not pulse coinciding. It comes after the carotid.
Basically, either with the other carotid pulse or with the
Even the, we may compare with the heart sound systole and diastole, S1, S2 also.
Yes,
if it comes after the S1, it is X descent. If it comes after the second sound, it is Y descent.
Any other question, Rahul? I think I have seen all the questions.
I think just all the questions are covered, sir, from the chat box. So,
madam, I think this talk was actually very means each valvular lesion, every question which comes asked is being asked is being covered, ma'am.
Actually, some of the questions I didn't cover this opening step S3.
Yeah, but overall, like it was almost. Full coverage of the all valvular heart disease.
Yeah. That itself became 5 minutes extra, so I was
thinking. That is 5 minutes. So many extra exam related points we have covered, ma'am.
Yeah.
So, thank you so much, ma'am, for this elaborate session on multivalvular heart disease. And I think it's one of the most important topic because valvular heart disease invariably remains a long case in almost all the exams, and almost all the questions related to each individual lesions are being covered that has to be. So again, I would like to thank ma'am for giving us time and providing insight into this important topic.
Thank you, sir.
Rahul.
I hope it is useful. Yeah.
Yes, sir. So ma'am, we are now towards concluding this wonderful program, the PG webinar series, which we have been doing for the PG students, ma'am. And I must say, this was an exciting program, which has enabled us to gain from the expertise from your side, ma'am. So I take this opportunity to thank you once again, ma'am, and also Dr. Sudhakar Rao for the great contribution to make this program possible and successful. And I'm thankful to all the participants who have taken their time out to attend this program. And I sincerely hope that your support will remain with Torrent in the times to come. And our platform is always available with you, ma'am. So
thank you.
Take
care,
ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Thank you,
Dr. Thank you, Sudhakar. Thank you, ma'am.
So we'll conclude here.
Yes.
We'll provide the recordings also in a few days. So we'll provide the link.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. We'll close the program. Take care, sir.